Now, interestingly, my sermon this morning is titled Mind the Gap. Who could have imagined? Really, it's taken from my visits to Jackie's place of birth. Jackie was brought up in what is, I think, referred to as metropolitan Essex. That's the posh version, anyway. Loughton Eye Road is where Jackie was brought up. And so often when we go to London, we go to that side of London because we go to visit family and friends and so on. And we'll, if we're going into London, we'll park there and we'll catch the central line, tube line, into London. And those of you who have been on it, and I think it's on one or two of the other stations as well, but you get to Bank Station and there's that constant reminder, isn't there? Mind the gap. I understand that for the coronation weekend, the King and Queen recorded a special message, which was played at stations all over the country, including a message at Bank and those similar stations where the King says, I would be rather grateful if you mind the gap. The reason being, because of the angle of the tracks and the curve of the platforms and so on, there is a danger, depending on where you get out of the train, there is a gap between the train and the platform. And a danger, of course, to your safety, because we don't want people to fall down between the train and the platform. And hence the constant reminder, mind the gap. And so, as we continue in this series, looking at the person, the purpose, and the power of the Holy Spirit, and especially as we consider at the moment, we're looking at the ministry of the Holy Spirit, his purpose, the reason that he came, and how he empowers us to know and experience the presence of God today. This morning, I want to focus on the intercession of the Holy Spirit. And in that sense, the way that the Holy Spirit stands in the gap. So let's read from Romans chapter 8. This is the third sermon, I think, in this series that we've been looking at Romans 8. I'll pray see those in just a moment. But turn with me, if you've got a Bible or a Bible app, to Romans 8, verse 26. This is what God's word says, Romans 8, verse 26. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know what to pray for as we ought. But the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And he who searches hearts knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. Let's pray. Father, we come to you. We thank you for these words penned by the Apostle Paul nearly 2,000 years ago, but yet under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit and the reminder of the Holy Spirit today, we pray, would they come alive to us once again? Holy Spirit, we pray, would you teach us from these words here today to encourage us, to challenge us, but to keep our eyes looking heavenward. So help us in these few minutes, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. As I said, this is the third time now that we've looked at this passage in Romans 8, as we consider the ministry or the purpose of the Holy Spirit. This chapter, of course, starts with that great statement, there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. What encouragement for us today. There is no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. And for those of us who know the Lord Jesus, who know that our sins are forgiven, who know the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, we can hold on to that truth today. There is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Paul introduces us in this chapter, flowing out of that statement, he introduces us in this chapter to the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus. This is in contrast to the struggle that he closes the previous chapter with. I want to do the right thing and I find myself doing the wrong thing. I don't want to do the wrong thing and I find myself doing it. And there's this internal battle and struggle in the life of the believer. And he raises the question at the end of chapter 7. Paul raises the question, who's going to deliver me from this body of death? Who's going to deliver me from this conflict, from this struggle that is going on in my body? And he says, thanks be to God through Jesus Christ, our Lord. So then I serve the law of God with my mind, but with my flesh, I serve the law of sin. And immediately going on to this section, there is then no condemnation. And introducing the law of the Spirit of life that is to be experienced by the believer. Matt spoke a few weeks ago on the early section or the early part of chapter 8 on the way that the Holy Spirit enables us to please God. The only way that we can please God is because of the precious work of Jesus that we've remembered again in the communion this morning, but also because of the indwelling Holy Spirit. And the indwelling Holy Spirit enables us to please God and to be pleasing to God. Not because there's any ability in myself, there is none, but because of the Holy Spirit working in me and developing something of the character of Christ in my life. And so the Holy Spirit enables us to please God. Then Dougie spoke a couple of weeks ago about the witness of the Holy Spirit. And that witness is that we are legally, morally, positionally, practically, functionally sons of God, adopted into God's family, that great principle of adoption. Our passage that we've read today goes on to address the practical struggles of our weakness. Let me say, if anyone tells you that being a Christian is easy, they're lying to you. Being a Christian is not easy. Praise God, we have the indwelling Holy Spirit to help us, to empower us, to lead us and to direct us and to point us out of our circumstances and to point us to Christ. But the life of the Christian involves struggle. It involves conflict. I've mentioned that briefly, what we get at the end of chapter 7 and the conflict Paul experienced and was referencing many, if not most, believers. But just because we accept the Lord Jesus into our life doesn't mean that everything becomes a bed of roses. Praise God, though, that we have the Holy Spirit who, in the analogy and the expression that I'm using this morning, was prepared to stand in the gap for us. And he's prepared daily to stand in the gap for in relation to our Christian experiences. So the truth is, the reality is, sometimes we may be so burdened by something that we don't know which way to turn. Or you may face such a daunting task, you don't know how you might possibly undertake this for the Lord. Or there may be such an insurmountable problem in your family or in your work situation or even in church life. There may be such an insurmountable problem that you're debilitating, you just don't know what to do and where to go and how to step forward. Or even as this passage suggests, you don't even know what or how to ask the Father. And in that situation, sometimes we find ourselves caught like a rabbit in the headlights, frozen. And that's the concept that that Paul is addressing here in verses 26 and 27. Verse 27 verses 26 and 27 introduces us the fact that it's the Holy Spirit who stands in the gap. The Holy Spirit, it is the Holy Spirit who himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. Now, some commentators and preachers have tried to suggest that this issue raised in verse 26 is just a simple thing. Well, I don't know which word to use. Or you're coming to pray and you don't know which particular word to use to describe something. That is not the sense of what Paul is presenting here. Because the antidote to the problem of not knowing, we do not know what to pray for as we ought, but the Spirit himself, the Holy Spirit, intercedes for us. So it's not just a case of sometimes I get a little bit of a stutter and can't quite get the word out, and somebody might jump in and say the word that I'm wanting to say. That's not what we're talking about here. It's not just that the Holy Spirit steps in and gives the odd word where it's needed, but he intercedes with groanings too deep for words. That shows us something of the depth of what we're dealing with on this issue of not knowing how to pray, not knowing what to pray for as we ought, to use the text in the ESV here. And so it is the Holy Spirit who stands in the gap. He makes that his ministry, as it were. It's just one aspect, of course, of his ministry. There is so much more which we've been trying to cover and give you a flavour of. But in this section, the Holy Spirit stands in the gap. He intercedes. Verse 27 goes on to speak of the Holy Spirit knowing our hearts. So it is as knowing our hearts and knowing the will of God, which we get at the end of verse 27, he's able to stand in the gap and intercede for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. And all of that leads us on to this very well quoted verse. One that we will often throw out off pat as a catch-all for any situation, any difficulty, when we can't think of anything better to say. Oh, but we do know that all things work together for good to those who love God and according to his purpose. Amen. And we just roll it out without really thinking about what we're saying, and especially without thinking of the context. The context here of that verse, of Paul saying that all things do work together for good, the context of that is the struggles that we go through, and we don't even know how to pray. And so what Paul is saying, yes, you don't know how to pray. And the difficulty, the struggle that you're going through might be so deep that you haven't even got words to express what's in your heart. But Paul says the Holy Spirit is standing in the gap. He's interceding for you. But hold on to this. As he intercedes, hold on to this great truth that all things do and will work out for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose.
Thank you.
Amen. He goes on then to say, for those he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son, in order that he might be to the firstborn among many brothers. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. I haven't got the time this morning to go into the detail of the depth of teaching that there is in just those two verses there. Suffice to say, putting it into the context of what we're looking at here, when we don't know how to pray, such is the depth of the struggle that we're going through. We don't know how to pray. The Holy Spirit stands in the gap. He intercedes for us. And as he intercedes for us, let us hold on to the truth that all things work together for good. Because God has predestined us. He has called us. He has justified us. And he will one day glorify us when we see Jesus face to face. So it gives us that context that all of this is in the Father's hands. And so the setting, if we look at all that and extrapolate that, the setting of what we're talking about here is that you will face struggles, you will face strife, you will face difficulty. Sometimes it's of our own doing because of poor choices that we make. But sometimes, for no fault of our own, something that's said by somebody else or done by somebody else that causes us such pain and anguish to the point that we don't know how to respond. We don't know how to pray, how to beg the Father. The Holy Spirit then in that moment intercedes for us. He stands in the gap. What glorious ministry the Holy Spirit does for us today. In relation to this oft quoted verse, all things work together for good, I remember someone saying to me after their husband had died, it got to the point that if somebody else wrote that in a card, in a sympathy card to her again, if somebody else quoted that verse again, they were going to rip the page out of the Bible because it really didn't feel like it. When you're going through the grief of losing a husband, when you're going through the pressure and the stress of a difficult situation, it doesn't feel that all things work together for good to those that love God, who are called according to his purpose. Friend, it never feels like that. But what I'm proclaiming to you is the truth of Scripture. And what the Holy Spirit is his ministry to us today is, as we go through those circumstances, he is interceding for us. He is standing in that gap that we're struggling with, so that we can hold on to that truth that all things work together. So we can hold on to the truth that God has called us and planned to call us and justified us through the precious work of the Lord Jesus. And it's the ministry of the Holy Spirit that helps us to hold on to this great truth. And in that sense, he stands in the gap for us. Sometimes you might want to say, yeah, but. No yeah, buts. This is the truth of Scripture. And the exercise that's been on my heart throughout this sermon series, and as we continue in the coming weeks into the power of the Holy Spirit, looking at the gifts of the Holy Spirit and how he empowers us to know God's presence today, the exercise that I've had over the whole thing is that we might know God's presence more. And here in this section, we're looking at the way that he intercedes for us. Why? So that when we're going through struggles, we might still know the presence of God. And the longer that you walk with Jesus, the longer that you fellowship with the Holy Spirit, the more you learn by experience the truth of this Scripture. And my concern, my exercise, is to encourage you. I'm not presenting anything that you haven't heard before, but to encourage you today that the Holy Spirit is living to intercede for you. He's made it his ministry. He's made it his priority. The Holy Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. Some have suggested, does that refer to speaking in tongues, when maybe we can't find the human language in which to respond to God, in which to praise and worship God, in which to cry out to God. I think it's too limited to narrow that down to just this expression. The Spirit intercedes with groanings too deep for words. That's not just speaking in tongues. I think it might include something of that. But the ministry of the Holy Spirit in this aspect is much greater than that. As he seeks to intercede for you as you go through your struggle. For me as I face difficulty and don't know which way to turn. The Holy Spirit himself intercedes for us. And I think what's suggested in this is that for us in our weakness, in our humanity, it's difficult for us to try and plumb the depths of really what is involved by the Holy Spirit interceding for us. The fact that Paul tells us that he intercedes with groanings which cannot be uttered gives us some insight as to the depth of this ministry of the Holy Spirit. And maybe there's a reason why these groanings cannot be uttered. Because of this great ministry. It is too great for us. Because that's why he's having to intercede for us. Because we're in that struggle. We don't know what to pray as we ought to. Because of the desperate circumstances we might be going through. The Holy Spirit intercedes in that moment. And it's because the Holy Spirit has stepped into the gap. It's because he intercedes for us that we can hold on to this truth in verses 28, 29 and verses 30. We can hold on to this truth with confidence. Not just with a blind faith saying, oh, all things will work together for good, but with confidence, knowing that all things will work together for good. If we love God, if we've been called according to his purpose, as set out in verses 29 and 30, if we're part of God's plan, if we've responded to his appeal in the gospel, and if we're walking with Jesus and knowing the intercession of the Holy Spirit, we can hold on with confidence to the fact that all things will work out for good. Now, the truth is, as I've said, we don't feel like this at the time. No matter how long you've been walking with the Lord, it doesn't feel like it at the time. But you still have to hold on to the truth of it. Because what God says in his word here in these verses, not that most things work together for good, or that some things work together for good, all things. Tim, what does all things mean? Well, it means all things. Simple as. There's no better explanation than what God's word presents for us here. All things work together for good. Now, maybe you're like me, and there have been many times in my life when you're going through a situation, you're going through a circumstance, you're facing a difficulty, whatever it might be, and you think to yourself, how can this possibly be? How can God bring good out of this situation? It's only as you continue with God and then you look back and you can see something of the all things. I've shared with you before, often facing situations, I will pray. And I will, because I think sometimes he needs a bit of a hand, I will give God suggestions of how he might answer my prayers. You can almost hear him chuckling. Because every time, whatever situation I think up in my head of, oh, this is probably how God will answer this prayer, every single time he does something different to remind me that his thoughts are beyond and above my thoughts and my ways. And if I held on more to this truth, that all things work together for good, then I wouldn't have to imagine how God might work it out and how God might resolve this situation. Just to hold on to the all things with confidence, knowing that the Holy Spirit is standing in the gap, knowing that the Holy Spirit is interceding for me. When I don't know how to pray as I ought. When we don't know how to deal in a godly way with a situation that maybe faces us. The Holy Spirit intercedes and enables us to hold this truth. And so my encouragement this morning is to hold on to this truth. It's really easy for me to stand here and tell you that. This is what you need to hold on to, friends. Hold on to the truth that all things work together for good. But I long for you to know and to experience that as you get into that situation where you do not know how to pray, to know and experience the intercession of the Holy Spirit, to know the Holy Spirit standing there in the gap with groans that cannot be uttered, bringing your heart, your petition to the Father. Because as verse 27 reminds us, the Holy Spirit knows our hearts and he knows the will of God. And so he bridges the gap, he fills the gap in that sense between where our heart is and where God's will is, and fills that gap, interceding for us so that we can hold on to this great truth. Now I put the quote in the bulletin this week from Oswald Chambers. Jesus Christ carries on intercession for us in heaven. Hebrews teaches us that he is living to intercede, is the expression it uses there. He's living to intercede for us. So Jesus Christ carries on intercession for us in heaven. The Holy Spirit carries on intercession in us on earth. Beautiful, isn't it? When you think of when you see there the Godhead, the three persons of the Godhead, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, working together in that way. The Lord Jesus is there at the right hand of the Father, interceding for us. And as I read earlier in the year in a book, it helpfully suggested that it's the Lord Jesus' constant occupation to intercede for us, even whilst we're sinning. It's not that Jesus comes to the Father and, oh, because he sinned last week, I'm going to intercede for him. Even whilst we're sinning, Jesus is interceding for us at the right hand of the Father. But then also what we have today in these verses today, that the Holy Spirit is interceding in us on earth. When we don't know how to pray, he's interceding even within us. When our physical body and our mind and our voice cannot articulate what is there in our heart, the Holy Spirit is interceding in us on earth. And Jesus, there at the right hand of the Father, is interceding for us. You see the Godhead, the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit working together. But then the challenge that comes out of this, and this is why I put this quote in the bulletin this week, and we, the saints, have to carry on intercession for all men. And that's the real challenge, isn't it? Takes us to 2 Corinthians 5. That's another sermon. We'll go there another day. We looked at it over a couple of Sunday evenings recently, didn't we? But as a result of knowing the intercession of the Lord Jesus, as a result of knowing the current ministry of the Holy Spirit to enable us to experience the presence of God, the Holy Spirit intercedes for us today. Something of the working out of that experience of the intercession of the Lord Jesus, the intercession of the Holy Spirit, something that is worked out should be our desire to intercede on behalf of man. And 2 Corinthians 5 prompts us and instructs us that intercession is be reconciled with God. It's that appeal to the members of my family, the members of my community, the members that we live around, that we work around, and so on. Be reconciled to God. It's that level of intercession that is involved, and that's the challenge for us as to how we put that into practice. So maybe next time you travel on the Central Line and go through Bank Station, or one of the other stations where they have these announcements, and you hear the words, mind the gap. Maybe you'll be reminded of this, of the ministry of the Holy Spirit, who stands in the gap for us today. When we don't know how to pray, when we are caught up with the magnitude of the situation we're facing, the Holy Spirit intercedes for us. And because of that, we can know the great truth that all things work together for good. Because we've been predestined, because we've been called, because we've been justified. And as I said earlier, one day, very soon I hope, we'll be glorified as we see Jesus face to face. Let's pray. Father, we come to you. We thank you for your wonderful provision for us. You've given us a Saviour. We've remembered that in the breaking of bread this morning. Where we were helpless, lost in sin, without hope, Christ died for us. We thank you for this great gift. But yet, Father, your giving was not over, because you sent your Holy Spirit to live in us. And not just to be in us, to be your presence in us, but to minister. So that when we don't know how we ought to pray, the Holy Spirit stands in the gap and intercedes on our behalf with groanings which cannot be uttered. We thank you for his great ministry. We thank you that because he stands in the gap, we can hold on to the truth that all things work together for good. May this be real in our lives, not just a verse that rolls off our tongue, but may we know the truth of this day by day through this week. So help us to put these things into practice and to know more of the Holy Spirit's intercession. We ask this through Jesus' precious name. Amen.